Nicholas Lidstrom is in the spotlight next on FSN Detroit.
The Detroit Red Wings are known for great leaders. And for as long as most Detroiters might remember, there was one man running the show. But now, there's a new sheriff. He's not what you'd call new in town, since he's been here for going on 20 years. He is the face of the next generation of Wings. He has the skill and the leadership to bring to Detroit what the fans expect. Victory. Nicholas Lidstrom.
Holmstrom tried for the tip. Now it's a 5-on-4. Open side, Lidstrom shoots, scores! With the Holmstrom screen in front, Nicholas Lidstrom, the defense points leader, is added to his total, and it's...
It looks so easy for him, and a little jealous in that department. You know, here I am running around and everybody else running around, but he just seems to just find a way to get out of situations and make the easy pass. And you know, it's just, like I said, a pleasure to play with him, a pleasure to see him play.
He's just good at everything. He doesn't have a weakness. He's a good skater. He's good with the puck. He's intelligent. Plays this position very well. Probably the most frustrating thing of playing against him would be his uncanny ability to hold on to the puck and at the very right moment make an excellent pass, and it's frustrating for a guy forechecking him because you know you got to get there, but as soon as you get there, he's going to pass the puck off and just slip by your check.
Years before his time with the Red Wings, Nick Lidstrom's dreams were focused more at home. As a boy growing up in Sweden, Nick couldn't help but play hockey. It's pretty much the national pastime, a tradition handed from father to son.
I played hockey when I was a kid, and I played hockey home in the street and in a little rink just inside where we live.
Well, I have three sisters, so they were more into horseback riding and that kind of stuff, so they weren't really into sports at all. So my parents, I guess I've got two older sisters and one's younger. So my parents took me to a lot of practices and games and even tournaments too. So they were a big part of me growing up and playing hockey.
It was driving to the rink and I was on the game. I don't know, it was outside, rink was outside. It was cold and I was always there to help him. So that was not so hard, just fun.
The fun began at an early age for Nick.
I started when I was 7, so when I started remembering being cold and playing outdoors, probably from about 8 up until I was 12. We didn't have indoor hockey, we didn't have a hockey rink. So just grew up playing outdoors. After practice was over, we had to shovel, we had to snow off before the Zamboni came out, and I remember being cold, and some days it was too cold, so you couldn't practice. Other days were mild, so you didn't really have good ice or you couldn't skate on the ice. So just growing up, I just remember being cold and playing outdoors. And once or twice, we get to play in the indoor rink where the other teams played. But that only happened a few times. If you went away on tournaments, you get a chance to play indoor. But most of the time, my first couple of years, we played outdoors all the time.
As Nick played more, his skills began to take root.
We had always think he was a good player, but I couldn't see how big and good he was. But when he was 14, 15 years, his trainer told me, the coach of the team, he's gonna be a big player. And I said, yeah, maybe.
In Sweden, you finish high school when you're 16. So when I was 16, I moved away from home, moved to a different city to play hockey. And along with going to school, I could exchange some of the subjects for hockey. So I had five hours of hockey during school hours from the age of 16 up until 20, which I think was a big part of my development, getting a chance to be more on the ice and work on skills and different things. So I think that was a big part of my growing up and being a good hockey player. Moving away from home when you're 16 wasn't easy either. You're used to having your mom there cook for you every day, wake you up in the morning, make sure you get off to school, and That was a tough first year for me to move away from home. I had to take care of myself. I had to wake up by myself, do breakfast, and come home after practice, after school, and have a quick dinner, go out to practice, come back, do the school work, and just get up the next morning. So it was tough a few years, you know, when you're all by yourself and you're really relying more on your teammates than your parents at that time.
Now away from home, Nick would rise through Sweden's Elite League, earning his greatest success to date in 1991.
That was my first year with the national team, and being able to win the gold medal in the finals, beating Russia 2-1 was tremendous. We had, going back to Sweden after the win, we had big celebrations. A lot of people showed up for the similar to a parade we would have over here. But it was just great to see all the fans show up, but it was great to start my international career winning a gold medal.
Nick's young international career would soon add a new nation.
I remember coming over here in May and really having troubles entering the country. I flew to Toronto and drove down to Windsor and try to go through the tunnel, but for whatever reason I couldn't get through. So we had to fly back to Toronto and fly from Toronto to Detroit, and that's finally enter the U.S. But once I got here, it was great to see Joe Louis Arena. Like I said, it was my first visit to the U.S. and everything seemed so big when I first got here.
Everything seemed bigger here, except for the ice.
The rinks are bigger in Europe. You have more time with the puck, making plays or going up ice with the puck, whereas here the rinks are smaller, they're coming at you faster. I think the players are better. So it took me some adjustment just to get used to playing on this type of hockey.
But the adjustment to life overseas seemed less challenging for Nick because of his experience as a teenager.
Coming over here was just another step for me. I've lived away from home for a few years. I knew how to take care of myself, and back then I had my girlfriend come with me as well, my first season, so I think that helped a lot. And Johan Garpenlöv was a Swedish player that played for the Wings at the time, and he helped me out tremendously too, just getting my way around Detroit and just getting to know how to work everything over here, from setting up a bank account to ordering dinners, to little things like that. Here really helped me out with a lot.
Things took off right away for Nick on the ice. Coming to the Red Wings in the same season as Vladimir Konstantinov, players with different styles, each highly effective. Early on, Nick had some help developing his playing philosophy to suit his skills and strengths.
When I first broke into the league, Dave Lewis told me to, as a defenseman, you have to play your position real well, because I wasn't an overly physical player. I wasn't going to run people over, go out there and knock someone down. So I knew I had to play my position right. I think that's been part of the way I grew up playing hockey, and the way Louis was a big part of teaching me how to play over here. So I think that was a big part of the way I play, try to be in the right position. And I think I'm more of a heads-up player, where I'm trying to make plays all the time, trying to look for the open player. Sometimes you have to hang on to the puck a little bit longer and have someone draw someone to you to make that pass. Other times you have to get rid of it real quick. So I think I know when to get rid of it quick or make that pass or hang on to the puck. I think that comes with experience too. Just knowing the players in the league, knowing how to play on this ice, and just knowing your skills.
There was another person who knew the ice and who was an early and important influence on Nick's approach to the game in the NHL.
I've heard lots about Stevie before I came here. He was, he was one of the top three players in the league, along with Gretzky and Lemieux. And finally getting a chance to play with him was great. Just to see him up close, and he had all the skills and the smartness, but see how hard he worked. I think that really helped me.
It's hard to find, particularly defensemen, that can step in right away and play and make an impact, and he was able to do that. So our team, I think we quickly moved up in the standings because we got players like Nicholas.
Nick and the team continued to improve and impress in the early 90s, But despite their successes, the Red Wings were mired in a disturbing pattern.
We had some disappointing seasons early on in my career. Early 90s, we were playing great in the regular season, but we just couldn't put together in the playoffs. I think once Scotty came here, he really emphasized playing strong defense.
Having left his native Sweden for life in the NHL, Nick Lidstrom was finding his way in Detroit, and the Red Wings were trying to find a way to translate regular season success into playoff wins. Their luck was about to change.
I think once Scotty came here, he really emphasized playing strong defense. And we might not have guys up there in the scoring race, but the team was winning, and I think the team concept really worked.
Scotty Bowman's emphasis on defense led the Wings to their first Stanley Cup Finals in nearly 30 years.
I think reaching the finals in 95 with the players that we had was just a step of getting closer and closer all the time to finally winning it.
They battled to get here for the first time in a long time, but they were beaten by a much better hockey club, much better hockey club.
The Wings were swept by the Devils.
It was tough, especially losing four straight. The players that was on the team, I think, learned that it's not that easy. You have to battle through to win 16 games. You can't just win 12. And I think we learned from that experience, all of us. That was really disappointing. But I was thinking, I was 25 years old at the time, and it's not easy to getting to the finals. And you realize that you just have to work hard once the playoff starts. It's no rest until it's over. You gotta be ready to play every night, and it's just gonna get tougher and tougher, so you have to be mentally prepared for that. And I think going through that, I think, helped us down the road.
Another key element that also helped Nick down the road, besides Dave Lewis's personal attention, the influence of Scotty Bowman's defense and Steve Yzerman's leadership, were the veteran defensemen he played alongside of early in his career.
McKrimmon having a great start to this season alongside of a rookie defenseman, Niklas Lidstrom. He wears number 5, and most say he's the best rookie in the National Hockey League today.
I've had some great partners throughout the years. They all had bits and pieces of turning me into the player I am today.
After losing the Stanley Cup to New Jersey in 1995, Nick and the Wings appeared to be on a mission the next season.
We were cruising through the regular season, winning games left and right, and just winning games easy too. And we were playing so well that we almost took it for granted winning games. And once you got to the playoffs, we just kept rolling. And finally we ran into Colorado, which was a hot team as well. We've had some battles with them in the past.
Now a giveaway, here's Forsberg coming out in front, scores!
Tell you what, he beat a pretty good defenseman, Niklas Lidstrom. I haven't seen that happen all season long.
The length of the ice, the hockey game is over.
Ending the season like that was really tough. We were playing so well throughout the whole year, and then, losing out in the conference finals was almost devastating. We were wondering if you're ever gonna get there. But I think the team just got better and better, and Scotty and the management and coaching staff added the players that they thought would get us over the hump and get us to the finals again, and it worked back in 97. Finally came together for us as a team. We played great as a team, and it was great to finally win the Stanley Cup. We've been so close for, especially the last 2 years, losing the finals and then losing the conference finals, and then we're finally back in the finals again, and we're going to Philly to play that first game, and sweeping them was nothing that we expected. We thought it was going to be a real tough series, and I think we were ready for a tough series, but finally winning that fourth game here at home, and just seeing fans go crazy, and a couple of days later, when during the parade, you have old men coming up to you and crying and thanking you for bringing the Stanley Cup back into town again is something that you'll never forget.
We would ask everyone's support and everyone's prayers. Our organization is devastated, and we hope and pray. afraid that our teammate Vladdy and Natsa will recover and things will go well.
Just days after finally winning the Cup, tragedy would strike the Red Wings family.
Right after the accident, it felt like it didn't happen. It was unreal. And then coming back the next season, you know, in the back of our minds, we were always looking at Vladdy's locker was right next to mine. So you're looking at it every day. You see everything in there every day, and you're thinking about him every day and what he's going through. And you just feel like you want to help him in whatever way. And I think the best way we could do is go out there and win. Play hard for him and win.
The Detroit Red Wings of 1998 are Stanley Cup champions.
And finally being able to do that, and Vladdy was there at the game and seeing him coming out on the ice, even though in a wheelchair, he's out there and being part of the celebration, and just felt great inside to see him out there again.
With a second Stanley Cup now added to Nick's resume, that list would get longer.
Steve Eisenman was our leader, so it was just a tremendous honor to be handed the Conn Smythe, so I didn't really expect that at all.
After two Cups in the late 90s, the Red Wings remained contenders, but came up short over the next three seasons. Not coming up short, however, was their great defenseman, Nick Lidstrom. Coming into the 2001-2002 season, Nick had been to the All-Star Game 4 years in a row, and he capped off 2001 with his first Norris Trophy. That summer, the Red Wings picked up superstar goaltender Dominic Hasek, and the hunt for the Cup was on again. Hasek immediately knew what he had in front of him with Nick.
There was so much said about him, how good he is, how great hands he has, how can see the ice. I think the best of him, everything is great about him, but what is most important as a goalie, you can depend on him every night, you know. He never takes a night off. He's always ready, every situation. Very, very rarely he makes mistakes.
With Hasek in the fold, the Red Wings went on to win the 2002 Stanley Cup, their third in 6 years. And Nick's stellar play was recognized, winning the 2002 Conn Smythe Trophy.
That was a surprise, too. I thought we actually... A lot of players playing great for us. Dom was great in net. Brett Hall scored some key goals for us. Steve Eisenman was our leader. So it was just a tremendous honor to be handed the Conn Smythe. So I didn't really expect that at all.
Fellow teammate, defenseman, and Norris Trophy winner Chris Chelios would have no argument with any accolade bestowed upon Nick.
Without a doubt, he's the best defenseman that I've played with, because watching him offensively, defensively, his leadership in the room, you know, what he brings to the table.
Along with his talent and leadership skills, Nick Lidstrom brings a stack of awards and accomplishments, including 4 Norris trophies, and in 2006, a most impressive distinction, winning Olympic gold for his native Sweden.
To the country, it means as much as winning the Stanley Cup for the people here in Detroit. It's the biggest event to win. You know, it's only played every fourth year. You don't get many chances to be part of it and have a chance to win it. You know, putting everything together as a team and as a group and being able to win that final game was just an unbelievable feeling.
And 2006 wasn't done for Nick. He also won the Norris Trophy for the fourth time in his career, and he was named Red Wings captain following Steve Yzerman's retirement.
It means a lot, especially coming in after such a player as Steve Yzerman. You know, I've always thought that Steve was going to be the captain when I was long gone too, because I was just so used to having him around and him being the captain and being the leader of our team. So just getting a chance to kind of follow his footsteps is something I'm real proud of.
Oh, that was great. I was proud of him. Yeah, very proud.
You know, I think he's perfect for the role. Mostly he's an intelligent guy. He's very level-headed, and he just sits back and takes it all in, and he knows. And whenever I was unsure about something, if I had a feeling something needed to be changed, I always went to Nick and said, Nick, tell me what you think, because I respect his opinion and respect his knowledge of the game.
We didn't name him captain. He just is the captain. He's the guy. He's in charge. But he's not in charge because he says more, or he's just in charge because of who he is. He's not Steve Yzerman, he's Nick Lidstrom, and he does it in his own way.
Always thought Stevie played, the bigger the game, the better he played. And he would always say the right things at the right time. You know, when team isn't playing well, or you need a little bit of a boost, or you need something, he would stand up, he would say the right things, and he would go out there on the ice and do it as well. So I think leading by example is one of the best things that Stevie did. He would go out there and he would prove it on the ice. What I try to do is lead by example as well. If you go out there and if you work hard and you try to do the right things out there on the ice, I think your teammates will follow you.
He knows what it takes, and I think everybody respects him so much. Such a good guy, so I'm sure they're doing okay.
From the cold ice ponds of Sweden to legendary status, Nicklas Lidström is considered by many as the top NHL defenseman of the 21st century. Playing for the Detroit Red Wings since the 1991-92 season, he's received numerous awards and has been a near regular on the All-Star team. Nick has proven a model of consistency.
He does everything right. It's not like you talk to him about, oh, you got to do this harder, you got to do that. That's not how it works. Usually when you talk to him, it's about the team or about player or about what can we do better. It's not about, hey, pick it up, Nick.
He just makes things so simple. I mean, we catch, you know, each other on the bench sometimes, just looking at each other like, how did he do that? Or, you know, did you see that?
Zetterberg. Hall, front of the goal. Lidström scores!
He's as good as they come, you know. He's sees the ice, he's so mobile and doesn't need to do anything more than he has to. You know, it's just, he's all over the ice without even doing anything. It's just so natural. And I played with him and of course, you know, and I remember most of him when he scored the winning goal last Olympics. And so it's been great knowing him and great playing with him. He's a great, great player.
When I first came here, I wanted to make the team. I didn't want to get sent down to the minors. That was that was my mindset, trying to make the team and then do the best of it. But I only thought that I would stay over here for a couple years, play 2-3 years maybe, and see what it was like, and then I would end up back in Sweden again. So I never really saw myself staying over here for 15 years.
I don't know how else to put it than he's just, in my eyes and in a lot of people's eyes, the best player in the National Hockey League right now, and he's a big deal.
He scored his 200th NHL goal, and Lidström with a tip of the hat.